I think that the local people have accepted us, you know, quite readily. And I've got many good friends here. And it's nice having friends, like all the friends in London are people in the business. And it's really nice to have a whole set of people down here that aren't in the business. I found they're just as interesting. There's something magic, you know, about Devon and Cornwall. And I think there has to be a reason why so many creative people are down here. And it really works for me. The first song I ever wrote down here was a song for the Moody's. It was called Voices in the Sky. I wrote that down on the beach behind me. And that was quite a few years ago. I'm a happier person now, and I think that probably shows in the music. I think this the new album is more optimistic, I think, than anything I've done before. I used to take myself, I think, a little bit too seriously. And I don't think I'm doing that anymore. And I think that's because I'm a happier person. And we're happier as a family.
Tell me about your family. You've got a little girl, haven't you?
I've just got one little girl, yes. She's 4 years old.
What's she called?
Doromy. That's her name.
Does she accept that Daddy's famous and a pop musician?
I don't know. I mean, she sees me now and again on telly. It's not as if I'm all that famous anyway. I mean, I'm not getting accosted in the street or anything like that, thank God. But I think she accepts it, yeah. I mean, one lovely moment, I played it at the Hammersmith Odeon last year, and there was a big crowd outside the back at the stage door of the gig, and Marie and Dorams were with me, and I got them into the car, okay, and then I came out and had a load of autographs and everything to sign. There was a big crowd of people, and I eventually got in the limo and closed the door, and Dorams said to me, "Hey, Daddy, all those people are shouting hooray for you." I thought, oh, great, you know, and then I think that was the first time she realised what I did. And she's singing on the new album, she's singing on a song called Raised on Love. We were going to get their stage school kids kids from stage school to do the song. And we thought, oh, we'd frighten them because we were a bit out of it that day and we were working very hard and keeping very late nights. So we thought maybe that wouldn't work, so we got our own kids in to do it. And they did it, they came in and just did it like they do it every day. Very blasé, you know, first take, we took it.
Band split up, I think my family life has been much happier. In fact, I'm a much happier person all round now. I was very choked, actually, when the band did break up because, you know, it was always very good for me. But looking back, I can see that it was the right thing to do. And strangely enough, I mean, family life does come into it. In the early days, and when we were building our success, we were just five guys travelling around in a band together, and it's like the pack instinct, you know, and you take on the world, you can take on anybody. And then we started getting married and we sort of got into what we used to call the Peyton Place syndrome with the wives and the families and that kind of thing. I never really suffered from it too much because my wife Marie has always been around the business and so she knows what happened, but some of the wives weren't aware of that. And I think almost that can, I think that was a small part that did contribute to the breaking up of the band. In the Moody's went past the point where we said, yes, we have earned $1 million each, but don't ask me where it went. There's so many other people in the business, you see, around, not just a band, there's managers, agents, lawyers and accountants. Now, I resent, actually, the intrusion of lawyers and accountants into this business. I think it's a shame. It didn't exist a few years ago, but when they got wise to
amount of money that it was possible to earn through just through record sales. And the group, I mean, the group will never get more than, say, 10 or 15% of the wholesale selling price of a record, which isn't very much. So the record companies make an awful lot of money, and they deserve what they can get. But along with that, with the big album sales particularly, came the lawyers and accountants, and I resent those kind of people. When you sign a contract with somebody, I mean, it's like they say, the contract only ever rears its ugly head when there's something wrong. And that's the nature of signing a contract with a record company. Unfortunately, it makes for a lot of argument. But I think you're always able to win through in the end, you know, if you put your point across. Like I say, we have our own studio, which eliminates the studio time thing. But I think Decca could be great again, and we're the only real artist that they have at the moment. But the machinery is all there to have a tremendous record company, and I would like to see them make a real comeback. As a matter of fact, I'm on DRAM myself, because our contract with Threshold ran out last year, and they called me up, and Sir Edward called me up and said, "Well, my boy, you're back on Decca." So I said, "Oh, well, after all these years, you know." And I said, "Well, who's on DRAM?" And he said, "Oh, nobody's on DRAM, my boy." So I said, "Right, that's the one for me. I'll go on DRAM. Great memories from the past, and Joe Cocker and Purple Harem. Cat Stevens was on DRAM in the early days. And of course, all the Moody's early records. So now I'm the only living DRAM artist."
Nights in white satin, never reaching the end. Letters I've written, never meaning to send. Beauty I've always missed, with these eyes before. Just what the truth is, I can't say anymore, 'cause I love.